My name is Urban Haas. I'm a field CIO for CDW. And with me today, I have Chuck Brinkley with our Converged Infrastructure Practice and Dave Hecker with our Managed Service Practice. And I guess as we begin today, I'm going to start with you, Chuck, and say, what is Data Center as a Service?
Allow me to answer it first in terms of what it is not, if I may, because there's a lot of mystery surrounding it. And there's a lot of questions we get. And fundamentally, it's no different than the technical resources you need and you use to run your business and your operations today. Compute resources, network resources, storage resources, and backup resources. It's still those, except it's consumed in a different manner. And inherently, there's a lot more flexibility to it because it can be delivered anywhere. It doesn't have to be in any different of a location than it is now. It can be in the exact same physical place in your data center, or it can be in a co-location facility in a different data center other than where you may have gear currently today. But fundamentally, it's still the same type of resources.
If that's the case, then what makes it different than what you're buying today?
Yeah, I will address that. It really is the same thing as what's being purchased today. And then you might say, why not just put this in the public cloud? Well, we know there's not always perfect applications for moving something that you're using today in your data center into the public cloud. So with that, there's restrictions. There's restrictions around the flexibility of how you consume it, where it can sit, latency. There's issues with data sovereignty and governance and control around those things that data centers as a service addresses head on. Not only that, you also get an operating expense balance sheet treatment, which is very advantageous for a lot of our clients because they're trying to operationalize more expenses. And further, they're realizing that having their team spend time on non-strategic initiatives like managing data center components, compute, network storage, is not valuable. So they're looking for a managed services partner to help them offload that and get their folks working on things that are going to drive greater value for the organization.
So you mean someone's doing the care and feeding of updates and other things like that, like I would get in a public cloud perspective?
Yeah, and then it can vary from very light touch managed service to more intensive in having more of those tasks taken over and addressed by a trusted partner like CDW.
Okay. Well, if that's the case, then why should one of our clients or organizations be interested in this? I mean, that sounds like a lot of benefit right there, but what else am I getting?
Yeah, it's really around that flexibility. It's so hard today to predict what your compute requirements are going to be 6 months from now, let alone 3 or 5 years, which is a typical amortization schedule when you're making a large capital investment in something like storage, network, or compute. So this gives you that flexibility in order to take advantage of that. Now, granted, not everybody needs that flexibility, right? So there's definitely going to be time and place to purchase in a traditional manner. Maybe you prefer capitalization expense versus operationalized expense. That would be another example of why data center service may not be a fit. But we're definitely seeing more and more interest and consumption from our clients into this flexible model. There's also an advantage to using a chargeback or a showback model to help the business units that you serve be responsible for the IT resources that they're consuming. So we know that budgets keep shrinking for IT departments, staff keeps getting more constrained, but the need for compute resources keeps climbing. And the model that most of our clients are moving to today is around how do we show that back or straight out charge that back so they have responsibility there. Data center as a service model fits extremely well with that because it's priced on units consumed. So it's very easy to make that correlation between utilization and that charge for those business units served.
Yeah, Dave, that's a great point. And on that note, if I may add, if it is still the case that somebody wants a particular product or technology, we can absolutely still use that as a pivot point to the options that we may help them choose, right? There are still certain customers that have standards that they cannot deviate from, and we can absolutely work within those parameters. The other thing I'd like to add, Urban, is operational efficiency. As David said before, all of these data center as a service offerings have at least some base layer of some managed service built in, and perhaps they have a lot of services built in. Your team can focus on far more important things, right? The other answer to your question that I would add, Urban, would be those in a transition. If you're moving to or from the cloud, if I may say it like that, from or to dedicated hardware on premises, that transition plan can be greatly improved by having a subscription to a variable metered consumption model instead of having to outlay a whole bunch of capital to something that you're going to transition to in a long time, or you're going to transition off in a short amount of time from now.
Let's try to make it a little bit more real world use case. I mean, is this kind of an all or nothing approach, you know, where, you know, I'm like a public cloud, I'm all in the public cloud. Can I do this piecemeal? I mean, how does this work for me?
Yeah, that's a fabulous question. And this fits in very well into a hybrid cloud strategy with which almost all of our clients are consuming on some level. So there are applications that are delivered software as a service. There's stuff that lives in the hyperscalers out there, and there's stuff that's going to stay on-prem. So this closes that gap and allows our clients to use compute or storage or network or all the above, however they see fit, in a location that's convenient for them. Maybe that's in their data center. Maybe it's in a co-location. Maybe it's at the edge. So this helps deliver a more rich customer experience, which is really around outcomes and how do we deliver IT to the business units and internal and external customers that are being served here rather than just purchasing technology. And it's customizable to how much service you need. Everybody's going to get the scoop of ice cream. Now, do you want chocolate sauce on that? Do you want chopped pecans and whipped cream and a cherry and sprinkles? That's up to you to how you want to customize it and make it work for your needs.
I've had a lot of interest and activity from my customers in this data center as a service lately. And thinking back to helping customers through solve those issues and through some of these things, I rarely talk to someone who needs to do all of the above. Like you said, compute, network, storage, backup. Most of them are already using some sort of software as a service today. Some of them might be using additional as a service, like unified communications as a service, and they're subscribing with their phones, desktop as a service, and their desktops are really somewhere else. This is a natural evolution that allows you to take the data center components and do the same thing. And oftentimes I'm talking about just backup as a service or just storage as a service, a component of data center. And then it becomes some sort of mix and match, just like you described, of having one component be optimized in some way and have one in some other way.
Well, that's exactly right. The practical reality is everyone we work with has some level of technology debt that they're trying to retire. And very rarely does all of it come up at one time where you have to big bang it. And that's where moving things to public cloud makes a lot of sense. Sure, if you're a startup, that's different. Most of the firms we call on today aren't startups. They've had legacy compute systems that have been built over years that they've customized as their secret sauce to give them a distinct competitive advantage. We understand that. That's where data center as a service is a great fit to put in modular components where it makes sense when the timing's right.
So if I could sum this up, what I'm hearing is kind of like that everything as a service kind of discussion we have where there's a lot of flexibility involved. You know, we can do as much as we want and, you know, it's easy to consume. That sounds great. What makes us better than others? You know, why would CDW be the right partner to deliver this data center as a service? And Dave, I'll start with you.
Yeah, I love this question. It's great to answer because being a member of the CDW team, we're in a unique position where we are a full service system integrator with worldwide reach. So what that means is we can take an idea all the way from business concept to assigning an architect to help identify what the appropriate technologies are to solve that problem, and then do the analysis of, does this go in the public cloud? Does this go into a traditional data center environment? Or do we make a hybrid cloud using data center as a service? Let's help with that financial analysis and then install that and then run that for you. So we've got all that capability, which reduces risk and simplifies the number of different partners that our clients have to work with, which usually means a lot faster time to value for them.
And Chuck, you want to get in the last word on this one?
Whether you're looking to subscribe to a product or whether you're looking to subscribe to an outcome, we work to full stack, full lifecycle solutions. We've been the largest partner of all of the hardware logos for years and years. And I had said up top that this is no different of product. You still need compute and network and storage and what have you. Folks like Dave and myself that have been scoping products and services for years and years are still gonna be able to bring that unbiased approach to find the right product for you. And again, if you're looking for a product, we can go down that path and make a selection based on that. Or because there can be some variance in the terms and the options of these offerings of these different programs by the different manufacturers, we can use that as our pivot point. And we can help you make a selection based on those, if those factors are more important than the partner of choice.
Your answer makes me ask a question. Is there any kind of term commitment involved? Especially if I'm like in some kind of transition, do I have to buy in for 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, like I might on a typical capital outlay?
Yeah, Urban, that's a good point. And the nice thing about this model is you can commit to a term that's comfortable for you and to a number of resources that make sense. So what I mean by that is you can start with a commitment level and get a more attractive price point with a level of predictability. If you don't know what your consumption is going to look like, then it's going to be worth the premium to have extra overhead. We know that IT budget cycles are difficult to predict, so the consumption is difficult to predict as well. When you do run out of resources, you've got to go to finance and go get approvals. By the time you get all those approvals and you get something ordered and it shows up, you may be out of resources. Data center as a service helps to solve that. So it's much more nimble and allows our clients the flexibility to scale up and down, like we've been discussing, depending on what those needs look like. And it's at a term that's really up to you. So there's different price points based on your level of commitment, as you would expect.
Thanks.
Yeah, so that end, Dave, don't forget there's also this notion of buffer capacity, which is always included in any form of any of these agreements. You will always get more on the floor than what you're paying for to allow you some burst capacity, whether that's a storage capacity, whether that is a compute and memory capacity of a server, whether that is network resources or whatever. And so inherently, in a way to support the answer you just gave, there is a physical factor of you will get more, but you won't be paying for it if you're not using it, unlike in that traditional CapEx model. If you want 100 terabytes on the floor, you have to pay for 100 terabytes on the floor. Whereas in this, for example, nice easy math of 100 terabytes, you might actually have 120 terabytes on the floor, but you're only getting billed for the 100 terabytes that you're using.
So in the terms of real world examples or customer success stories, do you have any examples you can discuss? And Chuck, I'll give this to you.
Thanks, Urban. That's a great question. Let me tell you about a customer whose backup admin happened to be retiring at about the same time they were considering switching backup platforms anyway. So instead of looking for new FTE to backfill that had the specific skills that they would need in order to carry on with that solution, after a long and careful evaluation, they had actually decided on CDW backup as a service, because now they're just after the outcome of the SLAs of the backups being completed, and effectively we are their new backup admin.
So Chuck, that's a great example. And I know with that client, in addition to just the time to market and the speed to deploy using backup as a service, they also had a pretty good advantage from a cash flow perspective. So they got the preferential OpEx balance sheet treatment, and they're able to preserve cash flow too.
That's a great point. Thank you for bringing that up. We had another customer who had the need to get a predictable, increasing, consistent price for their storage platform when they were due for refresh, but the capital outlay would have been just too much. So what they had decided to do was the mix that we talked about before. They had done storage as a service because they got a consistent and predictable per terabyte price in their contract, and they can scale up through the years they will scale up through the years in their usage, and the capital outlay to start off was none. The footprint to start off was minimal. So financially, this is much more viable for them to have a storage as a service. The compute that they're going to use connected to that very same project is a little bit more predictable, and the CapEx purchase of that was perfectly in line for their financial situation. So they have a mix of regular CapEx for their compute and then the as a service for their storage as a service.
This sounds great. How do I get started if this is something I want to do?
Yeah, I think quite simply, contact your CDW representative and get the request out there. And there are a multitude of resources like Dave and myself on our respective teams that are fully trained and prepared and experienced and ready to help a customer with this journey, no matter where they are on it.
Thanks, Chuck and Dave. That was really informative to me, and I appreciate, you know, what you've helped, you know, highlight in terms of what we can bring to the market for data center as a service. Thank you.